Welcome to the plugin session. In this session, we would like to discuss what plugins are and the Apache Cordova framework that those plugins live in, discuss which of those plugins are the common plugins that are included by default inside of the shell, and what other types of available plugins are available for downloading from the forge. There also is the capability for creating a brand new plugin inside of OutSystems, and we'll talk about the steps to create a reusable plugin module. So let's get started on the Cordova plugin section. So what is Apache Cordova? It's an open source mobile development framework that allows the use of standard web technologies for cross-platform development. So basically, by using HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript, it has the ability of generating the code necessary for the native platform. So given descriptions of that type of information, which is sort of standard web stuff, you would be able to use the framework and generate the Xcode for Apple or the Android and the Java code that you might need to be able to do that. So what are the plugins? The plugins are the code that's going to provide the interface between Cordova and the actual native component. So Cordova has the ability to go ahead and bind and communicate to the devices and its components, and then JavaScript can interact with the native code to be able to control and work all of that. So the Cordova framework has been around for quite a while, and it has this ability for us to define the web app and what we want things to look like, and the rendering engine will go ahead and render that for the device. So the mobile operating system will have different input capabilities, graphics, sensors, and services, and the Cordova plugins, there are a number of common sort of default plugins, and then there are also custom plugins that can interact with the device itself. And in their case, they're interacting with the mobile operating system and native code to be able to work on all of those pieces. Now, there are several of these plugins included inside of what we refer to as the default native shell. So there is the camera plugin that can take pictures and scan items. There's the contacts that gets you to the address book. Location, which sort of gives you where you're located in any given time, and network status. So which networks are you connected to and what is your current status on those networks. There's also the ability to access the calendar and receive local notifications from the device, and that would let our apps sort of create their own notifications as needed. So what are the other plugins that are available? And we'll go through most of these. So there is something to record audio, there's a scanner to help do barcodes, there's something that can detect beacons and tell us our sort of smaller, more refined location. Microblink and Card.io do some scanning, composing emails, transferring files, setting up a geofence, doing near-field communication, and being able to be a little bit more secure by using Touch ID. So the audio record plugin will capture audio and save it to the file system, and then the path can be returned by the plugin so that we know where that is. You can adjust this to make sure we don't record forever, so there is a maximum recording time that can be set, and then you can sort of preview it and decide whether to save it, or you could just then throw it away. There is a barcode scanning plugin that allows us to scan barcodes, and there are a lot of different types of barcodes, including the QR codes. So depending on what you're trying to scan, the barcode scanning plugin, if it's a standard and popular symbology, should be able to go ahead and handle that for you. There is a beacons plugin. The beacons are wireless sensors, and they broadcast tiny radio signals that the device can receive and then react to. So the beacons can be placed in different locations, they can be placed to objects, they use Bluetooth for low energy, and basically you're limited to a range of about 70 meters. So it's not going to work too much further outside of that. But The beacon itself will be on when it's sitting up normally. If you turn it upside down, it will shut itself off. But this gives us a little bit more of a fine-grained idea of where our location is, and that can sometimes give us extra contextual awareness. So this plugin will go ahead and handle local notifications and other types of things, because it'll need to know how many beacons and where you are, so there can be different types of updates as that goes through. Blinkld knows how to scan and decode lots of different types of documents. Now this requires a license that you need to go out and get from Microblink, but it then will scan certain types of barcodes, your passport, identity cards, so it's a fairly useful plugin to have. Similar to that, there's Card.io that can go ahead and scan any type of credit card information. So it will attempt to read and find that information, and there's a pretty cool demo out there on how that part works. There's also the email composer. If you need to compose an email in your app somewhere, it's easier to use the plugin. The plugin will then leverage and connect to the native mail composer on the device, and then you can send out emails as needed. There's also the file transfer, uploading or downloading files. Depending on how many files you have on your device and how big they are, you may want to be able to upload them to the device or download them off of the device to make things a little bit easier. There's a geofence plugin that creates a virtual fence or perimeter around a particular geographic area. So to do that, you have to define a set of coordinates as to where the virtual fence should be. You can either do a circular region where there's a point and a radius, or you can do different shapes like polygons so that you know where the fence is in exact relationship to the different things that you're looking for. So your position can be monitored relative to the fence, whether you're inside or outside of it, and then it can send notifications and alerts when you walk across the boundary of the fence. So the fence radius needs to be at least 100 meters, so it has to be a decent size area as far as the perimeter and fence are concerned. There is a near field communication plugin that enables near field communication. It's a subset of RFID's specification, and it's based on an interesting inductive coupling capability that basically lets there be certain types of active and passive devices, and they can transfer energy and communicate even if something doesn't sort of have its own battery and its own set of energy. But we're talking about very short distances here. You pretty much have to be within 4 centimeters of each other or 2 inches to be able to do this. Now, the near field communication also can read and write different types of data. Most of the time it's just reading, but if you wanted to go ahead and write, you can do that. There is a particular transfer rate, and that means that you're not going to be able to transfer huge amounts of information back and forth this way, but you could go ahead and use it to do relatively simple stuff. A big plugin that can be very useful for the Apple side of things is Touch ID, and that gives you fingerprint recognition on the Apple devices. So this can be used for authorization to basically say, okay, you're trying to do something, you know, I need to just verify that this is really you, so go ahead and give us your fingerprint again, and then it will allow whatever is going to happen next to occur. So at this point there are a little bit of a limitation for Touch ID. You can't just have any old iPhone. You need an iPhone 5S or better, or some of the more recent iPads to be able to work with those. So those are some of the plugins that are out there. There is also the thought of, I would like to create my own plugin. Well, if you go out to the Apache Cordova site, you can go to the area on plugins, and you'll actually find that there are over 1,500 plugins out there. So if you go research some of the plugins and you happen to find one you like, and you wanted to create an OutSystems resource inside of a module to be able to work with that plugin, First thing you would want to do is create the application and select a blank module inside of it. Then you could go ahead and enter the configuration for this plugin and the module. So basically we need the URL of where that information is. And then we could create some client actions to define the API. And we want to make sure that they're public so that we can reuse these whenever we need them. So there are different types of APIs inside of the application that may want to use the plugin. So we have to understand, okay, given the plugin, what are we going to expose and how are people going to use that API? So let's go through it step by step. If we go out to Apache Cordova, we look at the plugins that are there, we could go ahead and type something in and it would search for those types of plugins for us. So here we're looking for a flashlight. You can immediately find one and it gives you some information like, is this available for Android? Is it available for Apple? How many times has this been downloaded? When was the last time the code was updated? So you begin to get a better idea of each plugin and how up to date it is and what are the capabilities that it can do. So if we went into our Cordova plugin flashlight and looked at it in a little bit more detail, we can see that the installation says, okay, go ahead and use Cordova plugin, add the plugin flashlight, and it's available at this URL. Now down below, you can also see there is the usage, and the usage is, here is the JavaScript, and here are the codes that are, here's the JavaScript code that's going to be called. So there is, you know, being able to take the flashlight and switch it on, and then switch it off, or maybe just toggle it. But those types of information are there. So for us to create this plugin as its own module, we go out and create the app, create the module, and then underneath the module, down in the advanced area, just above the web services, or right next to the web services, we have this configuration. And if we go in and we place in the configuration that this is going to be a plugin, and the URL is going to GitHub and going to get this PhoneGap plugin for the flashlight, it will then go ahead and register and configure that so we know which of the plugins is going to be used. Now once we know the plugin and it's configured and registered, we then need to define the JavaScript behavior. So here we can go in and say, alright, we're going to take the window and use the plugins for the flashlight and switch it on. Now once we have this set up, we now have the JavaScript to be able to turn on that particular part of our flashlight. So in this case here you can see that this is the turn on method and it's just going to do what it needs to. You could do the same thing for the turn off action. So being able to know what the JavaScript is and then tie it to the OutSystems action so that we can make that available inside of the plugin, then we'll be in good shape. And then down here, once everything is defined properly, we want to make sure that it's public so that people can go ahead and use it. Once we use the plugin, then the plugin will activate the JavaScript and then the JavaScript will actually be doing what needs to be done. And the Cordova framework will be interacting with the devices to go ahead and make that happen. So in this section we talked a little bit about what the plugins are. We also went over some of the common plugins that are available, and they're available by default in the shell. We looked at what's available from the forge and how you could go ahead and create your own. There's one other scenario here where you might want to create a plugin that has never existed before, and no one from Apache Cordova's framework has attempted to do something like that. In that case, you might need to go out and write the real code and kind of go through the Cordova approach to be able to build something like that. But once Cordova has it as a registered plugin, it's very easy for us to wrap that and make it available inside of OutSystems. So a lot of different types of plugins, lots of information about plugins. look into the reference documentation for more details about how to use some of these plugins and how to create the new ones.